Grace and peace to you, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to welcome each and every one of you here on this morning. We're thankful for your presence among us. If you happen on this day to be a visitor with us, we're glad that you're here, that someone has perhaps invited you to be here, or that you have found us through the internet or in some other way. We're glad that you're here and would ask, we are beginning to ask that you sign a visitor card. We've got those back in the pews in front of you. If you are a visitor with us today, we'd love to have some information about how we can be in touch with you, an address, an email address, a phone number. Any of those would be wonderful ways of being in touch with you. But again, we're glad that you're here. You've come on a great morning. If you didn't know about it, there's going to be all kinds of good music. You've already heard some wonderful music from our choir. We have various instrumentalists who will be playing. We have handbell ringers ringing. We have children singing for you in just a little while. So you have come on a wonderful day to be with us at Georgetown Presbyterian Church. I do want to give thanks to our choir and to Mary Lou and our instrumentalists for all their hard work and putting all this together, as well as handbell ringers and our children also. A couple of things just real quickly to announce. Today is the Sunday for bringing your food for Helping Hands. This is a kind of an emphasis Sunday for that. That note is in your bulletin on the back page, so be mindful of that. If you have brought those food things today, the delivery will actually be on Tuesday morning, though. If in case you forgot to bring them today, you can bring them by tomorrow if that's convenient for you to do. The office will be closed on Tuesday of this week, and that is because your church staff will be out having a planning event for that day. It's not really a retreat, it's a work day, but we're trying to do some forward planning for the fall that lies ahead. And so we will all be off-site doing that important work, and we pray for your patience on that day, that the office will not be open and available to you for doing the normal things that you might do here at the church throughout the week. Also would like to note the date, July the 11th, 2 weeks from today. There will be Lemonade in the Shade, sponsored by our Congregational Care Committee. Information about that as well. It's a way for you to come and have some fellowship and refreshment, but also to contribute to our Vacation Bible School effort. And you'll see information again about that on the back page of the bulletin. July the 11th is also a VBS work day, an important day for volunteers and for kind of putting things together. If you'd like to be a part of that, I know that Marcy would invite me to invite you to be a participant in Vacation Bible School this year. We need all hands on deck. We're expecting to have a lot of children, and so we need a lot of adults and bigger people to help to support that effort. So please see Marcy about how you can be of help and how she can put you to work on the week of Vacation Bible School, July 12th through the 15th. And it will be in the evening this year, just to note that again, in the early evening hours. So that may be convenient for some of you rather than in the daytime hours, especially if you're employed with work during those daytime hours. Are there any other announcements that need to be made today? Let us worship the Lord together.
Please join me for the call to worship. We wait for the Lord. And in his word, we hope. More than those who watch for the morning. For with the Lord there is steadfast love. And let us pray. And these are words of prayer inspired by a prayer from President George Washington. Let's pray. Almighty God, we earnestly pray that you will keep us in your holy protection, that you will shape our hearts with a spirit of gentleness and peace, that you will increase our affection and love for each other in this church, in this nation, and in this world, that you will help us to do justice and love mercy, that you will help us to live with charity, humility, and mutual respect. Help us to be like Jesus, the divine author of our faith, and be with us now as we pray the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts,
as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please remain standing as you're able for a time of confession. We are a people born of water and the Spirit. We have made promises to be Christ's faithful disciples and to show his love to our life's end. Confident in God's grace, let us confess our sin and the sin of this world. Merciful God, in your gracious presence, we confess our sin and the sin of this world. Although Christ is among us as our peace, we are a people divided against ourselves as we cling to the values of a broken world. The profit and pleasures we pursue lay waste to the land and pollute the seas. The fears and jealousies that we harbor set neighbor against neighbor and nation against nation. We abuse your good gifts of imagination and freedom, of intellect and reason, and have turned them into bonds of oppression. Lord, have mercy upon us. Heal and forgive us. Set us free to serve you in the world as agents of your reconciling love in Jesus Christ. Friends, hear the good news. As people born of water and the Spirit, we have died to the old life and a new life has begun. Be thankful and live as one who has been raised to new life. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our first scripture reading comes from Psalm 130, verses 1 through 5. Let's listen for the word of the Lord. Out of the depths, I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I hope. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Amen. Our second scripture reading on this morning is from Mark's Gospel, the lectionary reading for the day. Hear God's word. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came out, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all that she had. She was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. For she said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware that power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. May God bless the reading and the hearing of this, God's holy and inspired word. Most all of us have had the experience of being in a large crowd of people, whether it was at some ball game or a concert or even a graduation ceremony. A lot of us have been to those in recent days. Or some other large gathering of people. Those of us who have found themselves in such a crowd know what a strange feeling it can bring sometimes. Maybe it's just the jostling, the feeling of having other people we've never seen before rubbing up against us that seems so odd. The boundaries of what we normally see as our private space are often violated when we're in the midst of a large crowd. Many people actually refuse to attend events where there are going to be throngs of people because they can't stomach the idea of dealing with all the crowds. Some people feel that way about attending a USC or a Clemson football game. I remember one dear elderly lady at a previous church who told me that she had always, all her life, wanted to hear Billy Graham preach in person, but she had no interest at all whatsoever in going to the crusade, which was actually coming in a few weeks' time to Charlotte, because she couldn't stand being in a crowd with 80,000 other people, and so she had no plans to go hear Billy Graham. He rarely preached crowds this size. It was usually 80,000. It seems to me that Jesus might well have been experiencing a bit of that same feeling as he constantly had crowds flocking about him everywhere that he went. Throughout his Galilean ministry, he often retreated to a lonely place, the scriptures say, in order to have some time to himself and to commune with the Father in prayer. I wonder if Jesus ever sometimes just got sick and tired of being touched. He must surely have gotten old. I wonder if he ever got used to it in his public ministry. What then do we make of the woman who came and touched his clothes, the hem of his garment, according to some of the older translations? At first, Jesus seemed a little bit perturbed that anyone would come along and try to sneak a blessing out of him. And we're told that he became aware that power had gone forth from his body. And so he turned and he asked the crowd, who was it that had touched him? He wanted to know. There was something about her touch that must have seemed to be of a different nature. The text says that the crowd followed Jesus and it pressed in on him. It makes sense to think that he was bumped into by some people in the crowd, that one or two of them perhaps had even had violated his personal space. And yet Jesus singled out only one person who had touched him. Let me try to paint a little bit of a word picture for what this scene might have been like. The woman, we never learn her actual name, but the woman had been bleeding for 12 years. Hemophilia, some other sort of bleeding, who knows? The condition of bleeding left her unclean in the eyes of the community. The book of Leviticus made it clear that she was unclean, and for a pious man, she was untouchable. Her plight was one of sad misfortune, and she had been relegated to live on the outskirts of town with the lepers and those thought to be possessed of demons. She likely felt ashamed and hurt, maybe even a little bit angry, all at the same time. No available doctor could do anything at all for her except to take her money and another piece of what little hope she had left. She seemed incurable. And yet, through all of this, her flicker of hope never extinguished itself completely. The house of her faith had shaky foundations, to be sure, but somehow was still standing, even after 12 years of suffering and humiliation. Maybe she received encouragement from the words of the psalmist who wrote, "Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord, Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word, I hope." One day, she saw the crowd approaching. They seemed to be gathered around a man she didn't know, she'd never seen before, and they moved quite slowly because it was difficult for the man to walk since the crowd pressed in on him so. Finally, she caught a glimpse of him, and for some reason, a wave of hope rolled through her, and she wondered if he might be the one. All at once, she felt herself being led as if someone was pulling her right into the crowd of people who surrounded the man. "If I can just touch a piece of his clothing, maybe the edge of his sleeve even, then maybe somehow, some way, I will be given a portion of God's blessing. I must have faith that he is the one who can heal me, the one who can restore me to my past life. He is the one who can make me whole once again." Now, the passage of Scripture doesn't tell us all that, at least not the part about what she may have been thinking, what she may have been feeling. All we know is that she has been hemorrhaging blood for 12 years and cannot be cured by conventional means. As I said before, we never even learn what her name is. But it seems quite evident that she was a woman of steadfast faith, a person who never completely lost hope in God. A cynic might say that she was desperate, that she was willing to try anything after 12 years of suffering. But there was something about her touch that was distinctive. And Jesus knew it immediately. He sensed it. It doesn't seem to me that her touching Jesus' garment was a last-ditch, I'll-try-anything-now attempt to take what wasn't really hers to take. Even if we acknowledge her level of desperation, her action was not some shot in the dark by a woman whose faith in much of anything was lost. Instead, her touching of Jesus was an act of great faith, an act of trusting in God to provide healing no matter how dark the present situation might have seemed to her. The seemingly obvious message of her story is that we shouldn't be afraid to reach out for the love of Jesus to bless our lives. We shouldn't be afraid. Faith surely demands from us a response to embrace our Lord and Savior in a spiritual sense, if not in the physical sense that is spoken of in the story. It is the Holy Spirit that brings us into full communion with Christ, that leads us to experience God as we have already been embraced by God with gifts of grace and faith. As God has reached out to touch us in our lives, so too do we reach back to God and touch the hem of Christ's garment. Some years ago, a movie came out entitled The Seventh Sign. Some of you may have seen it. It wasn't a great movie, but it was okay. Demi Moore was the star of the movie. It depicted events that led an expectant mother to seek out the advice of a Hasidic rabbi, a noted linguist, regarding this mysterious and ancient document that she had come to possess. She arrived at the rabbi's apartment and she knocked on the door. When he came to the door, she reached out her hand to shake his hand and to introduce herself and to tell her about what her request was, but she had unknowingly violated his cleanliness code by crossing over the threshold of his completely kosher residence. He quickly slammed the door in the face of the very startled young woman who had no idea about the severity of the thing that she had done, of the strict standard of cleanliness that she had violated by her simple but well-meaning action. If Christ had been any sort of ordinary rabbi, any sort of ordinary priest, he might well have done the exact same thing. He might have rebuked the woman for not observing the Levitical code and for contaminating him. But of course, those sorts of distinctions were not very important to our Savior. They were of no real consequence. The need to address suffering always, always, always trumped the need to remain ritually pure. An amazing thing about Christ in the scripture for today is that he is portrayed as a savior for all sorts of people. Jairus, the synagogue leader whose daughter was dying, and the woman who touched his garment both expressed belief that Christ could restore life, that Christ could bring healing. But they were from two different stations of life, to be sure. One was clean and the other wasn't. The one held a prominent place in the community. One lived on the outskirts of town. One of the phrases often used in reference to Christ is that he is the Son of Man. We often hear him spoken of as the Son of Man in the gospel writings. And I think that here we have at least some sense of what that might mean. Christ was sent to serve, and he was an agent of God's grace, a grace that calls people together, regardless of whether they're clean or unclean, regardless of whether they're Jew or Gentile, regardless of whether they're black or white, regardless of their status, their socioeconomic status in the community. God is a light for all the nations. That's the mission of Jesus Christ. We might all do well to consider who it is that we deem to be unclean, and therefore likely beyond the reach of God's grace. We might also consider the things that the stories of Jairus and his daughter and the woman who touched Christ's garment have to say to us about the power of touch. In one story, Jesus takes a little girl by the hand and he tells her to get up. She's restored to life. And in the other, a woman touched Jesus and is restored to the life that she once knew, is clean of her hemorrhage of blood. Touch is indeed a powerful part of the healing process. Remember a lecture that I attended in college where we were in that class studying the effects of cancer. The professor that day did something that was really different. We weren't talking about cancer from a scientific standpoint or anything like that so much, but really from a more personal standpoint. And he took us on a personal journey of his, and he began to speak with tender affection for his wife. He had recently lost her to cancer. Just a few months before, he gave us this lecture, and he told us of the last days that she was alive and of their visits together in the hospital room where she was. They chatted about many things, trying to remember all of the good times and the milestones with fondness, in many ways going through an inventory of the life that they had shared together. But he said that something that really stuck with me, the reason I'm telling you this, I suppose, when he told our classroom that the single thing from which he and his wife derived the most comfort was simply sitting together in silence, holding hands. Holding hands with one another. There was a power to that experience for both of them, something that went well beyond the ability of words to express. Touch has an amazing capacity, an amazing ability to bring healing when we need it. There are well-known studies that were done of orphans back in the days of communist Romania during the regime of the despicable dictator Nicolae Ceausescu. Due to extreme poverty and lack of resources throughout the nation of Romania, orphanages there became overcrowded and therefore understaffed. Small children, infants, and toddlers went day after day neglected and failing to come into direct contact with any care provider at all. They went untouched for days and weeks at a time. When these neglected orphans were closely studied years later, it was discovered that they often could not speak or relate at all to other people. They could not give or receive affection, and they lived their lives devoid of things that most all of us take for granted. There is a power in touch that all of us need to feel, both from God and from other people. Sometimes we may hesitate to physically touch other people for fear of violating some boundary of personal space, and there is certainly some merit in observing appropriate use and occasion for our touching one another. I know teachers and all of those who work with children and youth have to be especially careful in this matter, a very delicate matter. One of the things that as a minister I have to discover in each of every congregation that I serve is who are the huggers and who are not. And there are both in every single congregation, I can tell you that. There are people who want to get that hug, and there are people you better never hug. And you have to learn who they are. I have to admit that I'm just getting used to shaking hands and exchanging hugs after not being permitted to do very much of that since March of last year. But there's no doubt that it was difficult for us not to shake each other's hands or hug each other after church services or anywhere else, for that matter, during this pandemic, and not exchanging those greetings and those moments of closeness, but rather living life apart from everyone else with a 6-foot distance imposed. You won't get many hugs from 6 feet away, I can guarantee you that. The truth is that not many people like having someone hanging all over them. We've had that experience too, probably. Somebody continually tapping you, patting you on the back, or tapping you on your knee, or grabbing you by the arm. That gets irritating after a while. We've all met those folks who can't seem to keep their hands off to themselves and off of us, but the warm embrace of a firm handshake, or the fond hug of greeting among friends, or the hand on someone's shoulder to express a word of concern. These are, it seems to me, appropriate occasions of touch, and I think important ways that people say without words that they care and that they show the love of Christ to each other. If you're one of those non-huggers, and I know you're out there, That doesn't mean that your faith is weak. That doesn't mean that you're doing anything wrong. Of course not. But I do think that you may be missing out on something that seems significant when you can't show forth love by a gentle and loving act of touching someone else. There is a power to touch. Amen. Before I begin our prayer this morning, I am going to return to a custom that has been observed at times in our congregation here of allowing you to speak aloud prayer concerns that you have, aware that God will hear those concerns, that they might be a part of our prayer on this morning. What are prayer concerns that you have, particular individuals or needs that you know of? You can simply speak them aloud where you are seated. Let's turn to God now in prayer. O God of creation and redemption, we give you all praise and glory for the ways that you reach out to claim us as your own by the amazing grace that is yours and yours alone to give. We lift to you the prayer concerns that have been spoken aloud. We know that you are so keenly aware of the needs that we have, both as individuals and collectively as a congregation of God's people. We pray that you would hear these concerns, that you would address the needs spoken of aloud by our people on this morning. How grateful we are that you have loved us enough to send us Jesus Christ to be our Savior, and that you provide for the church by the indwelling presence of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we are thankful also for the gifts of family and of friendship, and find ourselves richer than we deserve to be by virtue of these gifts. Our prayers on this morning extend to deep places of human need as we pray on behalf of families who are grieving the loss of loved ones, as we pray for individuals who are missing a friend, as we pray for others facing uncertain futures, whether physical or otherwise. We lift to you those making significant decisions about lifestyle or commitment, those in need of revitalization, those who are confronted with seemingly impossible dilemmas and decisions to be made, and those coming to terms with debilitating illness and disease. Lord of light and wholeness, we petition you for help in our own personal journeys of faith. Give us purpose in our prayer. Give us purpose in our study that we might grow in our relationship with you. Make us servants of our fellow travelers in this life that we may serve your kingdom by serving others. Have us to be good stewards of the gifts and the resources that you have entrusted to us, and thereby bring hope to even the darkest of situations. Gracious God, be a source of care to young people who are facing peer pressure to do things that they know are not good for them, that they know are not good decisions to be made. We pray that in these summer months you would be with children, that they may grow and mature in ways that befit your purpose for them. We pray for parents and for grandparents to raise children to know you as Lord, and we pray that you would give them wisdom at times when they feel incapable of making all the right decisions. Lord, we pray also for community leaders and government officials, for the responsibilities that they have and the policies they make, that those policies might lead others to be better citizens of your commonwealth. And on this Sunday in the week approaching the 4th of July, help us to treasure the wonderful gifts that we have as citizens of this country, not perfect, but blessed in so many different ways. Inspire us all, whether we be participants or interested bystanders, to take seriously the responsibilities we have of service, things that we're called to do, the ministries we are called upon to support. Lord, all of these concerns and the private meditations of our hearts, we submit to your loving care in the holy and righteous name of Christ, our living Lord and Savior. Amen. I would invite you now, if you are able to do so, to please stand and to say with me the words of the Apostles' Creed as we affirm the things that we believe together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you.